Welcome, Dr. Ramanan. Dr. Ramanan is the Mission Director of the Atal Innovation Mission. It gives me immense pleasure to invite you, sir. Atal Innovation Mission is a national innovation initiative of the Prime Minister and the Government of India under the Niti Aayog. And the goal of AIM is to establish and promote a culture of innovation and entrepreneurship nationwide. We ourselves at the NUDS Center of Innovation, Social Innovation, are part of the one of the programs that AIM runs, which is called Atal Innovation Center, Incubation Center. As the mission director of AIM, Mr. Ramanan has been instrumental in launching many nationwide programs which are focusing on innovation and entrepreneurship. So it was obviously natural for us to bring Mr. Ramanan to the session here to talk about innovation and specifically innovation for India. During the COVID crisis, I was on this common WhatsApp group where we were constantly conversing about how can the Atal Incubation Centers come together and participate as a common infrastructure for people to learn from each other, innovate, come up with ideas and solutions for the problems in India. And what better time to discuss this than now. And so it would be great, Mr. Ramanan, if you can give us a little insight about your transition into this space, because you had an illustrious corporate career before you moved into creating this new sort of infrastructure opportunity for young startups in the country. And what are your thoughts on making for India, building for India's problem, and how do you sort of motivate young startups or young ideators to think about social problems or problems of India and build for them?
Thank you, Priya, and good afternoon or good evening to everybody who is onto this call. I do hope every one of you is very safe and healthy and hearty under these very trying circumstances that has gripped all of us, not only just in India, but across the rest of the world. And the COVID-19 crisis, of course, requires all of us to be practicing some practices that has been advocated by the government as well as by the healthcare industries. And I hope all of you are doing that. Thank you also, Priya, for the opportunity to share my views today on a topic which is absolutely important for every one of us to deliberate on. And I was listening to part of the session, the earlier session, and many of the topics that were discussed are absolutely relevant to our country. For after all, two things have happened right now. One is a COVID-19 crisis, which has descended upon us totally unexpectedly, swiftly, without any warning whatsoever, and has paralyzed the entire world, I would say. All nations are in the grip of this particular crisis. Many countries have locked down. It has disrupted supply chain management across between boundaries, not only in the boundaries of countries, but also boundaries of states. We are experiencing something which we never in our wildest dreams imagined would be possible. And we are actually having also an opportunity at this point in time to deliberate and reflect on what this means in a post-COVID world. Because it's completely changed many assumptions that we have traditionally held dear or refused to let go. And one of the big things, and your focus is on social innovation, one of the big things that has come out of this COVID-19 crisis is the realization. Is the realization that never before in the history of our humanity has science, technology, research, innovation, education, all of these forces have to come together to address this particular crisis, leveraging technology and leveraging what is happening in the world. The crisis is a simple virus, and a simple virus has paralyzed nations and economies. So imagine the effect of other things that we have been neglecting at this point in time. We have neglected so many things. We have just talked about it. People have referred to it. Climate change is an issue. Poverty is an issue. Access to clean drinking water and sanitation is an issue. Affordable housing is an issue. The effects of climate change and pollution and all of that can acquire epic proportions of the sort that we are experiencing now. and we have not been focusing on that. So this is, so when I look at social innovation, you know, from my viewpoint, you cannot really distinguish between social innovation and economic prosperity or economic growth. Of course, the world has been obsessively focused on economic prosperity and economic growth. And as a result of which, even a very advanced country like the United States is now struggling. So how do I deal with this pandemic crisis, where so much of focus should have gone into medical research, into addressing potential pandemics? Not that this pandemic was unknown to the rest of the world or not anticipated to the rest of the world. I mean, when you look at the YouTube number of people who have talked about potential pandemics, it is amazing. And they're all brilliant people. People like Bill Gates have talked about it and others have talked about it. But somewhere we have not paid attention. And now COVID-19 has brought that right to the forefront. You know, the issues that really affect humanity, the issues that affect us in terms of if you don't have good health, if you don't have a habitable climate, habitable planet, we are in a great danger of letting go of everything that we have built over the last several years or last several centuries. So I also think that this is the time for us all in India to see, to look upon COVID-19 as a great opportunity. And I can see very clearly over the last several years, you know, India being building up as a startup nation in the world. We have more than 30,000 startups. And we have all those, the five pillars that the Prime Minister, Honorable Prime Minister addressed, which has to become the basis of what we are going to do going forward. First and foremost, we have a demographic dividend, as he mentioned. And that demographic dividend is the envy of many a country. We have 1.3 billion people, but 65% of our people are under 35 years old. And that's a tremendous force, a great force multiplier in terms of what one can achieve and what one can do in our country. But many countries don't have this intellectual capability, the youthful energy and the youthful intellectual horsepower that is required. Now, in addition, if you are a country of 1.3 billion people and 65% young people, but we didn't have the educational institutions or the science institutions or all of that, then that would not be of great use. But we have actually built 1.4 million schools in our country. We have 10,500 engineering and related institutions. We have 39,000 colleges. So we have this 150 million educated Indians who are going to come into the workforce. Now, how do we harness this demographic dividend into driving innovation and entrepreneurship in our country? Because the future of our country is based on innovation and entrepreneurship. You cannot assume and you cannot expect that the existing companies, the traditional companies which have been there over the last several years, and there are only few of those companies in India, can take on the burden of these 150 million workforce. You have to create thousands of job creators. You have to create thousands of entrepreneurs, millions of entrepreneurs in this country. MSME, Nitin Gadkariji in his various addresses has said that we are aspiring that 50% of our GDP should come from the MSME industry. So that is an important number because we are only 30% of our GDP is coming from the MSME industry. And why is it so important to us? Because 70% of our country is not in the tier one cities. More than 70% are in the tier two, tier three, hilly districts, coastal districts. We have 600,000 plus villages in our country. We have 733 districts, out of which 115 of the districts are called as aspirational districts. And we have to ensure, and if there is anything that this COVID-19 crisis has shown, it has shown the importance of uniform development of our country and to be able to address job opportunities and create job centers everywhere in our country. Now there are, from a social point of view, I mean, let's look at the social point of view. How do we ensure that a country of 1.3 billion people, we have affordable housing and shelter for all? You know, the Roti Kapda Makan movie that was so famous, right? First, ensure shelter. You have to ensure nutritional food for everybody, not just food, but nutritional food, because we still have, while we are a self-sufficient agri economy, but we still have 1 in 5 infant maternal mortality, 1 in 3 infant stunted growth, and so on. We have to address this nutritional aspect, nutritional food for all. Third is you need electricity and basic electricity for everybody. I mean, if you don't have, you're not connected, you don't have the power of electricity, and without having to cause, without causing more problems because of generation of electricity. So we need renewable energy focus, and we need to ensure that there is affordable electricity and available electricity for all. Then we need to ensure that there is healthcare access for all. You know, everybody should have access to affordable healthcare, and they have to have not only quality healthcare, but access to the nearest hospital and so on and so forth. And finally, you also need to ensure that educational access is available to everybody. Because if we have, no Indian should be uneducated, especially when you're looking at this huge 65% under 35 years old. We need to make sure that we march into the next century or into this century in the next 10 years ahead through skillful, intelligent deployment of education and access to education across the length and breadth of the country. Any person who's educated is going to change the future of the country. There is no educated person in our country today, or for that matter, I know anywhere, whose life has not got better for himself or herself or for his family, to make sure, you know, we have to do that. And we have to access uniform development everywhere. So this is the reason why the Atal Innovation Mission has taken on this responsibility of how do I drive innovation and entrepreneurship by setting up an ecosystem. We have never lacked for great innovators or engineers or thinkers or scientists and so on. All of you who are part of this call and many of the people who have spoken, they have achieved tremendous things. So intellectual capability is second to none, or probably superior to many, many nations. And when our Indians go abroad, they become the Satya Nadellas of Microsoft and the Sundar Pichais of Google and all of that stuff. How do we create that same ecosystem where thousands of Satya Nadellas and thousands of Sundar Pichais can bloom in our country? That is the challenge. So when we look at this, what do? We, as Atal Innovation Mission, most of you may be aware, but very quickly, for those who are new to this call, there are five major initiatives we have taken right from the school level to the industry level. At the school level, we want to make sure that our children who are studying in schools acquire a problem-solving, innovative mindset. They all have to become problem solvers, innovators, not just rote learning students who are seeing, let me get good marks, go into a good university, get good marks again, go abroad somewhere and study in a good university there, and then join Google or IBM or Facebook or whatever. We want them to become problem solvers and innovators, so that when they're graduating from universities, they are thinking, how can I start a startup? And that startup could be a social innovation startup. It could be a commercial innovation startup. And there can be no commercial innovation if it doesn't have a social angle. It has to have the social angle. If that has to be sustainable, that has to be, that is scalable, and that has to be replicated, you will need to bring that angle and that consciousness into every innovation that happens in our country. The second thing is we have set up thousands of tinkering labs, and you can read about it. But essentially, these tinkering labs have provided a tremendous platform for young students between grade 6 to grade 12 to get themselves familiar with the latest technologies that are happening out there in the marketplace. So what we are doing, we have created a platform that can continue to grow. Tomorrow, if a new technology comes into the marketplace, a do-it-yourself kit for that particular technology gets introduced into the school, the students get familiar with it. So you are bridging this very crucial gap that we talk about, you know, the industry education gap. Many people who graduate from the universities are not employable. Why? Because you have forced them on an educational system which is not current to the times. And so when they go to the industry, they say, hey, we have nothing to do here. You know, I mean, you guys have to be retrained all over again. So how do we ensure that we constantly bridge this gap, and this platform will enable that? And I'm sure such a platform should also be introduced and will be introduced at the university level, because university education is also changing rapidly. The third thing is, second thing we are doing is we are setting up incubators across, and Encore Foundation is a great example of a social incubator or a socially driven incubator. And these incubators would foster 25 to 30 startups every 2 years. So we have launched about 100 incubators, 70 of which are operational. And we expect that 5,000 startups will come out of these 100 incubators, which will all be world-class startups. We don't want to set it for anything lesser than that. We need world-class incubators with world-class startups. And it is possible. We know how to do it. We have got a $180 billion IT, ITS industry, which has been built by most of you people. And that is world-class. And we are delivering services world-class. And the world is dependent on us. And it has brought many countries here to do their R&D innovation in India. So when we are capable of doing that, every one of our startups should become an investable startup, a world-class startup, delivering world-class solutions, which could be for the social impact or for economic impact. And then to make sure that the benefit of innovation is felt across every part of this country, nook and corner of the country, we are setting up other community innovation centers. And these community innovation centers will become the hubs, because we have 733 districts. How are we going to, and we have only 8 tier one cities. And if you expect that the entire population of India is going to come to these 8 tier one cities, God help us in how we are going to face the future. So we want to ensure that we are creating great 100 smart cities are there. All these should become great hubs of job creation and job enablement and skill development and having access to facilities, so that you don't have to come all the way to Mumbai or to Delhi or to Pune or to Madras or to Chennai to be able to get access to either education or healthcare or whatever. So that is a great opportunity for every one of us to participate in and see how do we bring smart cities, smart villages, and create hubs of innovation and hubs of entrepreneurship where thousands of MSMEs and startups can come up. And we are also setting up, we are launching what are known as New India Challenges. And these New India Challenges are to create product innovations relevant to our country. And so now with this 20 lakh crore economic stimulus that has been given by the Honorable Prime Minister and the Finance Minister, we have a great opportunity to rethink of India as it and in the next 10 years. Not only for the uniform growth of the country that is required, but to address all the social issues which is contained in our country and thereby also ensure economic prosperity. You address the social problem, you create the road and the pathway to economic prosperity. There is no two doubts about it. And those who think that, oh, you cannot spend on this without affecting the other one, they're grossly mistaken. Because you cannot, as somebody said, if I spend money on training, is it a waste because those guys will leave the organization? No, if they leave and if you create untrained people, your organization is going to die anyway. So you have to invest in this and you have to believe, and I'm totally confident that that is going to have its own impact on the economic prosperity of the country. And finally, we are launching something called Arise, which is Applied Research and Innovation for Small Enterprises. And this is targeted towards the MSME industry. Gadkari ji said that we want MSME industry to contribute to 50% of our GDP. We are today contributing about 29% to our GDP. So how do we ensure that? We have to ensure livelihood creation. We have to ensure training, skill development. We need to digitalize the entire operation. I mean, why this, if anything, this COVID-19 crisis has shown is the power of the digital medium and how it has brought together people from the industry, academia, government, everyone together to deliberate and to address the problem. I'm coordinating a group of COVID-19 related solutions on behalf of the Department of Biotechnology, DST, Startup India, Invest India, MeitY, and so on, all the government departments. We launched a search for COVID-19 related solutions that can be immediately deployed within the next 3 to 6 months. We launched this search across the industry. We didn't restrict it to startups. We said across the industry. But lo and behold, what has happened? This 30,000 startups we are talking about, if somebody thought that that was a waste, this was the time when it proved that how useful that focus has been. We received more than 2,000 solutions which are ready to deploy for COVID, which are preventive assistive solutions. The curative solutions, of course, people are still on the search, but there are many proposals that have come where people are already been working on certain vaccines or certain curative solutions. So what is heartening to find is the startup community resoundingly responded to this call for solutions. We have identified 155 of them, and now we are supporting them through either financial support or manufacturing support or piloting or regulatory support to be able to be deployed and implemented in different parts of the country. But that is the power of the startup nation. If we all get together and make sure that we become a very innovative country and we look upon this COVID-19 as crisis, as an opportunity of creating an India that is converting a million challenges that it faces into a million opportunities for entrepreneurial development, nothing could be better. So with this, I stop. I would like to take on some questions. I may have exceeded some of the time that I had been allocated. Of course, I can keep going on and on with this subject, but I'll be very happy to take any questions.
No, absolutely. I think you've exactly covered the exact thing that we want to do in the social innovation track, is to talk about how innovation has to be inclusive, how innovation has to take care of the problems at the grassroots level. Innovation has to go beyond the top 8 cities, but also in create infrastructure in smaller cities, smaller towns. And so absolutely hit the right point. So that also means that some of my questions you've already answered, Mr. Ramanan. But I have a few questions that have come.
I wanted to emphasize, because when you mentioned about inclusivity, how important that aspect is. One of the things that we have been specially focused on, and everybody in India should focus on, is how do we empower the girl child and the girl student? How do we empower women entrepreneurs? So AIM is very strongly focused on the women entrepreneurship platform. We have a WEP platform in the Niti Aayog that has been created for this purpose, where an aggregation of all the women entrepreneurs, successful women entrepreneurs and aspiring women entrepreneurs, can register onto the system and learn from each other and get supported also in their entrepreneurial initiative. Yes. And secondly, in the Atal Tinkering Labs, what was interestingly our observation is that in the last Atal Tinkering Marathon that we ran, where more than 50,000 students participated, the top 100 winners, 33% of them were girl students. And that was an amazing observation for us. And that number is only continuing to increase. So with this, the focus on women entrepreneurship, women, girl child, as well as giving opportunities for, irrespective of gender, caste, creed, location, aspirational district versus the more evolved districts, this focus, uniform focus, has to be there, which will enable us to grow as a nation.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. So there are a couple of questions that have come up, and I will quickly take one or two questions, time permitting. One question is around innovative ideas. There have been a lot of innovative ideas. There have been a lot of pilots. There have been a lot of idea generation, but there has been a lot of lack of funding opportunities or basically taking them to the market. And how do we bridge that gap?
Yeah, so the funding opportunities are actually increasing, but what we have been doing is to bring a very conscious awareness of the startup opportunity. Now, for example, in the COVID-19 crisis, I'm very happy, one positive outcome of this is there has been a very strong collaboration between industry and corporate and the startup industry, because we reached out to the startups for solutions, but we also asked them, what support do you need? And we reached out to the corporates like NASSCOM and the industrial association like NASSCOM and CII, and we told them, how can you support us? And with this, the awareness of what the startups have been able to deliver and develop has also been an eye-opener for the corporate industry and the other industry partners. So I am sure that this is going to have a very positive spin-off effect on the entire startup movement in our country, because it is like, the analogy that I want to draw is the Y2K analogy. You know, when the Y2K problem was there, a lot of Indian companies went and, became the target for a very economic way of solving the Y2K problem. Yeah. But in that process, the entire world came to India, and as a result of which our IT industry just boomed. Because suddenly the awareness of what the Indian IT industry is capable of grew in the eyes of the multinational companies. Mm-hmm. The same way this COVID-19 crisis is going to bring that to the surface to all the corporates, and the need for innovation and the need for entrepreneurship, that is going to be felt. And I'm sure that's going to have an impact.
There is one interesting question about agriculture. And I know that we've talked a lot about entrepreneurship. But there was a migration from agriculture to the urban cities, and now there is a reverse migration happening. So what are opportunities around agriculture as a livelihood area? Because a large number of people in India in the rural sector are involved in agricultural activities.
I think, we are very fortunate to have, India is a very fortunate country in terms of it being perfectly situated We are rich in agriculture. We're rich. We are the largest dairy producing country in the world. We have natural resources. We have hills, we have forests, we have fruits, vegetables in plenty. We have mining resources also. And then we have the demand and supply. You know, the supply is, we have a demand which is very large, one of the five pillars that the Prime Minister talks about. And we have a supply capability. So, you know, in a manner of speaking, the focus on agriculture should now be, why are we, for example, importing cheeses? Why don't we manufacture cheese here? Why do we import food products? Why can't we do all of that here? So there is a huge food development industry. I mean, today, if you see, you know, people are preferring to buy food from outside, and Zomato and Swiggy and all are really, you know, serving the industry very well. How do we ensure that our food industry becomes not only stops importing, but starts exporting a whole lot of value added food products and whatever products that we can create. And we can become, I mean, a small country like New Zealand is one of the largest exporter of dairy products in the world. So a large country like India can be an exporter for the entire world. So, you know, that is a great opportunity for, and I would say that the challenges in agriculture have been, one, how do we ensure that we can, you know, bring together multiple small farms and support them with help, you know, congregate them together and have larger farms and so on, so that the benefits of economies of scale can be applied. Precision agriculture is very important, and value added food processing is very important. If these three things happen, India should focus on the, I mean, it is a 44% agri economy based country. So you cannot wish it away and say that everybody should migrate and start building cities and all of that stuff. Why do you have to do that? You don't have to. And in this crisis, if anything else, one positive thing was most of our agri districts were not affected by the COVID-19. So if tomorrow, I think everybody is going to start moving away from cities and probably be having their own plantation and doing all of that stuff.
Yes, absolutely. I think I will ask you one last question. Sure. There are a lot of ideators and innovators on this platform. There are a lot of people who are considering thinking about social problems, because the social consciousness is at all-time high. There are people who are exploring development sector. There are people who are already working here. Is there a message that you want to leave for people who are thinking about entering this space or thinking about social problems and building solutions for them?
I just want to say, think more about it and get onto it. This is the time where innovation, entrepreneurship is the need, and it is the future. You have to be an innovator. And even if, you know, it is not that you have to be an entrepreneur. You have to be entrepreneur in your thinking. You have to be innovative in your thinking. You have to be a person with ideas. You should not come back and say, somebody has told me to do this and I'll do it. Don't accept the status quo. Question the status quo. You will be great in your job also as much as you'll be great as an entrepreneur. And this is the time of the opportunity. It is the golden time of opportunity, because there is a need. I mean, look at the problems that are facing the world and look at the opportunity to solve the problem. That is, one is you can have problems and you are worried, how am I going to solve this problem? I don't have financial resources, I don't have the technology and so on. Now you have everything. You have the people, you have the processes, you have the technology, everything is affordable, you have the intellectual horsepower, and you have the economic growth that this country is at a point where it can leapfrog into the world, as Dr. Mashelkar says, pole vault into the future. So we should pole vault into the future, and we should have great innovation and entrepreneurial spirit in the country, and we should become a land, the most innovative country in the world.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ramanan, for taking the time out and being here. It was very inspirational to hear about your journey at the Atal Innovation Mission, as well as different areas that the government has been helping build the infrastructure for innovation ecosystem. We look forward to working with you, sir.
I look forward to the same, and thank you so much for giving me an opportunity.
Thank you.